PHYS University, where even the squirrels are social distancing. It's General Physics 1. Today, Newtonian gravity, featuring orbits. Dr. Stenson, also a very special guest. And now, a man who's known online as Fiberpunk. Professor Hafner.
So today we're going to cover gravitation. We're getting into gravity a little bit beyond just weight, beyond F equals mg. And we're going to talk, but first we're going to talk a little bit more about circular motion, then more general gravity, and then orbits. All right, attendance dropping off. We're down to 125. It'll be interesting to see what happens next week with a review. Maybe it'll be higher, maybe it'll be lower. Maybe people will want to just watch it online later because they can watch it at 2x. So for those people, I have to say, stop watching at 2x. All right, so we'll see how that looks. Okay, so that's the attendance. And let's see, how are we doing? I don't think you guys know this story, because usually Cosette Marius is not that high. But if you love physics that much, I'm very excited. I am very happy. So that's good. Let's see. So another thing to announce real quick is the exam is next week. All right. So again, next week is we'll review Tuesday and Thursday. I'll be sending out messages asking what you want to cover, practice problems, whatever. And we'll be giving you more info about the exam and what's on it and what to study and how to get ready. And plenty like that will start happening as soon as this lecture is over, since I'm done with this. Okay, so Dr. Stenson, anything I'm missing you want to mention?
No.
No. Oh, pledge problem, yeah. And pledge two is also next week, right? It's due next Thursday, I believe, Dr. Stenson.
I'll post it today, and then it'll be due next Thursday.
Okay. Right, so that sounds cruel, the day before the exam, but it's the ultimate way to study, right? I mean, it's not like it's independent of the exam. Doing pledge two will be part of your studying for the exam. And also, there's no new homework assigned next week. So Canvas Homework 4 is the last one. It's due Wednesday. It only has like 9 problems on it. Okay, so I think then we're ready to get going. And I wanted to just do a little bit more circular motion. And I wanted to start by talking a little bit more about this loop problem that we did. So remember we talked about, I'm not gonna write down every bullet, but the question was how fast do you have to go to stay on the loop? So we said, well, the key is that at the top of the loop, you are in uniform circular motion, just at that point, right? You're probably slowing down due to gravity or speeding up due to gravity, but at this point, you're in uniform circular motion because you're going this way, V tangential, but your acceleration and the forces, every force you can imagine is vertical, right? Normal and gravity are all down. So you have your AC that way. You know, at other points on the loop, V would be that way and the force would have a gravity component, it wouldn't be uniform circular. So one key to the problem is realizing it really is uniform circular motion at the point where we asked you that it's uniform circular motion. We did a quick Newton's second law after we did our free body diagram, right? So we did free body diagram. We had, it was like this. We have mg down and the normal force is down. And that was another big question. How can they both be down? It's not moving down.
Right.
But when something, you throw something in the air, it's accelerating down the whole time. It's just like something throwing up in the air. Here it has to be moving sideways, but who cares? It's accelerating down. And when we did Newton's second law, and this time I'll make it positive in the downward direction, right? We have the normal force plus mg equals ma. Or now the a is the centripetal acceleration because we're going in a circle. Or you could write, if you want, normal plus mg, all magnitudes here, I'm not writing vectors, equals m, that vt we're looking for, over the radius of the circular motion. So we would give that to you in a problem. Other problems, we say find the radius because you have other information, but here you'd be given, okay? But really the big problem here is conceptual. That's what people wonder about. How can, like the question is, what is the minimum speed, right? So you have, so I just want to do clarifying bullets here. Minimum speed, because normal force can only push, is really the way to think about it. So the normal force is going to come into play in this equation. We'll show you in a minute, but it can only push down. Its magnitude can vary all the way to zero, or it can be very high, right? The normal force always pushes back with whatever it takes to make the motion happen, but it can't pull, it can't suck, right? So that's the problem. So it can only push, it can't be negative mathematically. So let's think of it this way. Let's do a spectrum of all the possible speeds that you could be at the top of that loop, all the possible tangential velocities. And let's use our intuition a little bit. If you're going really fast, you're going to make it around the loop, and you're going to be like pushed into the seat. Right? So let's say that you're going sufficiently fast to get back to the problem. The problem asks, what's the minimum? Okay, so sufficiently high VT. What's going to happen here is, if you're fast, VT squared over R, or MVT squared over R, is going to be big. Okay, and this equation, this is a big number. Now, we're going fast. Big number. This, constant. How do we make this equal? If that's a giant number and that's a constant, you got to add in some normal force. The normal force can be as big as the track can withstand. Okay? So in this case, when you're fast, the normal force pushes down. And that's why when you fly through really fast, you feel heavier, right? The track is pushing you. The track is pushing you to achieve AC. Right? What if you're going too slow? Now let's slow this thing down. All right, so slow, what happens is MVT squared over R is small. Small term here, equal to this sum. MG, though, is constant. It can't go to zero. How are we gonna get this small? Can't, this can't go negative, it can only go to zero. So when V is really small, this equation can't work. And that's because if V is really small, you'll probably go wah, 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 wah. And if you're going fast enough to get fast here, you'll fall off the track. Maybe you'll almost make it done, right? So somewhere in between these two, you make it around. And that's the critical thing we're looking for. And maybe now you can see the key is, as we get slower and slower, normal force gets smaller, 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 smaller. But here it equals zero. And that's the moment when you're barely making it around the track. So really solving this problem, all you do is you solve that. And right, that's what the answer is, just the square root of g times r. Okay. So I want to go over those conceptual parts, because you are going to do this in the homework. I think you do one of these, but you also do, what if you drive a car over a hill like that? And it's sort of the same, and it's sort of the opposite. Okay. And in case you have no intuition for this, I want you to watch a quick snippet from a movie called Bullet from the 60s. Where they drive really wild in San Francisco. Okay, so if you've ever driven in San Francisco, you need to watch this full clip sometime, because it's what you want to do, but you can't do. Here we go, here, front board. Okay, watch his tires off the hill. What about the bad guys? Off the hill. All right, so they flew off the hill. So that's what we're thinking about in this case, is if you go really fast, you fly off the hill. If you go really slow, you stay on the hill. And you got to think about the normal force and everything to get through it. Okay. So that's a little more information on how to do that one. And the next one, we also have a video for. Hold on. I'm going to go ahead and play it while I flip the board here. So this is a carnival ride called the Gravitron. Yeah, here we go. All right, so maybe you've ridden the Gravitron before, And it's, that's pretty much what it's like. I'm not sure what is more nauseating about the Gravitron, if it's the spinning or the couple holding hands on the ride. Okay, so the question is on the Gravitron, what VT, what translational tangential velocity is needed to hold you against a wall? How fast do you have to go? We could think of it in terms of omega or just the tangential velocity that you're actually going around the curve. So if you're like, I have no idea how to do this problem, then you may need to edit your tattoo. Step zero is draw the whole setup. Sometimes if you don't have any idea what's going on, you can't do the free body diagram yet. So here I would draw this. So here you were rammed against the thing, whatever, pushed against the wall. And now you can do your free body diagram. You treat yourself as just a point. All right. I can always add this one, MG down. And now it goes a little bit, you gotta stretch your use of these physical concepts. You're used to thinking a normal force is something that's sitting on a surface and it points up and maybe it has to counteract all of MG or maybe only some of MG because of a rope or something. But it's not always just horizontal surface. It can be a vertical surface. So if a surface is pushing into you for some reason, that also is a normal force. Okay, so I'm just gonna draw it here. There is a normal force like this. It might be a little hard to understand why since we haven't done this kind of normal force yet. Sometimes it's called a contact force. But you'll just have to use your intuition to realize that the wall is pushing you. Or use your physical knowledge to realize I need a force in this direction to create to give me a centripetal force so that I'll have centripetal acceleration. And really the wall pushing on you is the only one. So that's why that's the normal force. So then why don't they fall? There's friction force. A static friction force. That's another little subtlety to think about. We're moving. Why is it a static force when we're moving? And what really matters with static and kinetic friction is the interface can't be moving. You know, the whole thing can be moving together. It's just, is the interface sliding? So here the interface is not sliding. So it's static friction. Okay, so you've succeeded in drawing your free body diagram. And now you apply Newton's second law. And we're going to apply it in two directions. And I'm going to get even trickier on you. Last time I said vertical and horizontal, and the centripetal acceleration is horizontal. I'm now just going to call it the centripetal direction. Right? So the word centripetal means a direction. It means center seeking. Right? So centripetal, I don't know what that means. Okay, so let me do the sum of the forces in the centripetal direction equals the mass times the acceleration in the centripetal direction, also known as the centripetal acceleration. And the sum of the forces in the y equals the mass times the acceleration in the y. Let's do the centripetal direction. Let's see. So what are all the forces in the centripetal direction? So look at your free body diagram. There's not even any components to do here. Oh, that'd be a cool ride. What if we tilted it down? Okay, I have to think about that. Okay. All right, so the only one is the normal force. Just doing magnitudes. The normal force must be equal to mass, and the centripetal acceleration is, we can go ahead and put it in terms of this velocity that we care about. And you would be given the radius of the ride, probably. Yeah. Okay. So now we're kind of stuck. We don't know the normal force, but that's how we do y. Because the whole point of the question is in y, the floor has dropped, by the way. That's why there's no normal from the floor. So if we're going to stick to the wall, to hold you against the wall means those two have to balance. It basically means there's no acceleration on the y. Right? So let's say force of friction, static friction is up, mg is down, just writing magnitudes here, equals zero. They're not accelerating y, so then clearly fs equals mg. We can go ahead and write mu s n equals mg. Sn equals mg. So here I'm realizing the way I'm solving this is for right at the critical static friction, where, you know, or it's less than or equal to mu sn. We're doing equal. So we're saying you're wearing something really slick and you're barely pulling this off. I'm solving this for a case where what's like the slowest you could go, or what is the lowest kinetic friction, or the lowest static friction coefficient you could have. So I didn't think of that ahead, so I should have stated the problem more clearly. But still, we're getting some physics out of this. I've now clarified it, so I'm not going to be fired. Okay, so let's stop solving. N equals mg over mu s. And you can bring that over here, right? Mg over mu s, that's our value for n, equals m vt squared over r. All right, then you see, oh, it doesn't, the mass doesn't matter. That's why you can have little kids and adults on this ride and spin at the same speed and not worry about it. Everything will be fine. Okay, so then blah, blah, blah. So we solve this for VT. And look at this. It's about that same thing. I told you, everything will have GR in it. All of these, will it stick? Will it fly off the road? Will it make it through the loop? But here it just has this mu S on the bottom. But again, we haven't done a full problem because we didn't get into any minimums. And because I just said those were equal, this was sort of a critical thing. So this would be a way to find a minimum V, maybe, if you knew these, or a minimum US if you had V. Okay. I just wanted to walk you through one more rotational problem before we go to gravity. All right. So, let's see. So I think you have a gravitron on the homework that'll be more thorough. Okay, so I'm gonna erase, and then we'll start gravity. See, gravity. All right, so what is gravity? Gravity is an attractive, I'm gonna write force, even though interaction would be more general, but an attractive force between every pair of bodies in the universe. Whoa, every pair of bodies in the universe. Like your thumb and some rock orbiting Saturn in one of the rings. Yes, there's an attractive force between your thumbs being pulled towards that rock orbiting Saturn. Now the forces may get so small you could never detect them or measure them, such as in that case, but it is a general force between all things. Newton figured it out, and he did this thing where really what physicists love to do, where you realize multiple phenomena are connected by one equation. That's what he did. He figured out how the gravity, how it works on the Earth, which is pretty straightforward, weight equals mg, is connected to how the gravity works out in the solar system and the universe, etc. So here we're talking now about the general gravity, not just about gravity near the surface of the Earth. We'll clarify how those are related soon. Okay, so between two objects. We have a Newton's third law thing going on here. So M1 here, M2 here, and they have some separation like that, and the separations we'll always do to the center. Okay, we're treating things as point masses anyway, so if it's a spherical thing, we'll just say the center of the sphere. All right, so they each feel a force, attractive force. So this one, I'll label as a F21, and that means the force that two creates on one, and this one I'll call F12, the force that one creates on two. So the second subscript is what's feeling the force, the first subscript is what's causing the force, and here we go, the force that one applies to two. Oh, let's just talk about the magnitude right now. It's something called big G. That's actually what we call it, big G. We never just say G. Big G, the mass of one, the mass of the other, times that R squared. And if you'll be really thorough, you write R12 there. Right, to remind yourself that's from 1 to 2. Okay. If you'll be really, really thorough, you make it a vector. But we don't want to square a vector in the denominator because then it'll get into a Babel thing. Okay, but what's interesting is that's the magnitude of F12, but it's also the magnitude of F21. Whenever two bodies pull on each other gravitationally, it's the same magnitude of the force because it's an action-reaction pair. Right? If they weren't equal, then you would be creating momentum in the universe, and you can't do that. Okay. So action-reaction pair equal the direction we'll get to in a minute. Well, I drew the direction here, but we'll talk more about the direction here. What is G? G is a constant. It's just a number, 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 Newton meter squared per kilogram squared. Okay, so you're going to have to use that number a lot when you do homework. R is the distance between, and I'll write centers to remind you that we're really treating this as a point mass at the center. And the direction of the vector is toward the other mass. There you go. That's the magnitude of the formula. Okay. Let's calculate one to see what kind of magnitudes we come up with. Because this next calculation, or the great thing about gravity, is that it's always an attractive force. Okay, so what that means is we're all attractive. Everyone is attractive all the time. We're all attracting each other. So to bring it to more of a human scale, what we want to ask ourselves is, if you see someone across the room and you're attracted to them, how much of that is gravity? Right, so that's what we're going to ask ourselves. So here is you, and here is someone you are attracted to, someone, right? And let's say you see him across the room, say 6 meters away, okay? And we're gonna calculate the force real quick, just to show you how to use that formula and make sure we do it right. So the force that someone is applying to you, that you're sensing as an attraction, but you don't know that it's really just gravity because, you know, you're kind of hopeful. You got G, and you need your two masses. And these numbers are actually, it was supposed to be me and a student, because it's a different demo in person. It's not about this kind of attraction. So I'm making up new stories. So there's typical masses in kilograms. Okay. And then over the separation, 6 meters, 6 squared, 36. So you do that. And one thing to know is if we start calculating forces, gravitational forces between sort of typical earthbound things, people and cars and stuff, the number's gonna come out really small. Okay, so that's normal. So if you get something really small, it's okay. The numbers are really small. So you do all that and you get 843 times 10 to the minus 11 newtons. If you wanna put it in a proper thing with a prefix and everything, that's 8.43 nanonewtons. Must use nano on this campus here, 8.43. So you could say what kind of, how much of this attraction I feel for this person is gravity? Not much. So that is the weight of a mosquito's leg. Pretty light, not a whole lot. So if someone asks you if you find them attractive and you want to be nice, you can say, oh, a little. Okay, anyway. That's enough attraction jokes. I think we're done with those. Okay. So now we're going to talk about, oh God, we're using up our board. We wasted a board on that. Oh, what were you thinking? Let's look at these while I do a quick erase. Now we're going to get a little bit into the subtlety of the direction. It brings up a tricky thing that you could probably take 125, get an A+, and never think about this. But if you start thinking deeply about some problems, or if you maybe you go and do more mechanics in the future, this will become an issue. So I think it's worth just a couple of minutes. As soon as I see what time it is. Hold on. I have all this stuff on the clock. It's like 10 screens, no clock. Okay, so let's look at the direction and why it is problematic. If I was on Twitter, I would say, this direction is problematic. Okay, so we got mass one here. And we have mass two here. And like we said before, we have the force two on one. We have the force one on two. And that's what we mean by is attractive. And you'll notice I'm avoiding writing it in vector notation. If you forced me to write it in vector notation, it would look like this. The force one on two, say, the one plus the two. I'd say, well, let's make that the origin. Put this the origin, and I would write negative g m1 m2 over that magnitude r squared. That was the separation. R hat. Oh my God, what does that mean? So that's a unit vector. That's the thing, its magnitude is one. It doesn't affect the magnitude. It just tells you the direction. And the problem is gravity is in spherical coordinates. Or if you just want to think in 2D, you can think polar coordinates or circular coordinates or something like that. But the point is, when you're in spherical coordinates, every direction is positive. When you go out from the origin, that's called the radial direction. All right, so you go out. This is why we use R for position, okay? Because most things in physics are circle. So you point out, any direction you point out, it is positive R hat, okay? The negative sign tells you that it's attractive, okay? Let's see, so the force one on two, that one applies to two. Unfortunately, I've drawn it in the positive direction. What have I done here? See, I think I meant to be, say, 2, 1. The force that, no, I have the origin. Anyway, the negative means it's attractive. Okay, I'll clean that up later, but don't worry about the negative. But the point I'm trying to make is about R hat. Okay, so R hat is a tricky part. And the point is, this is hard to write in Cartesian coordinates. Okay, because what you say you want to describe this in 1D. Right, here you got M1, here you got M2, and you know the forces look like this. You know that's how it works. But you could say, well, I'll just write the same thing. I'll say the force is minus G MM over R squared I hat, because this is the x-axis. Okay. And you would get it in like in this, if we put the origin, okay, I'm putting the origin here. I think that's what I screwed up over there, the origin here. Then the force we get is, okay, so we're about the force on two, the force that one applies to two would be like this, how far away it is, right? It feels a negative I hat force coming this way. So you'd say this must be the right equation. We're just calculating this force. One applies to two. Here's one, here's two. Okay, negative I hat this way. What if we now put this thing over here? Which way is this going to say? Well, we're on the negative side, but it's R squared. It's still going to be positive. Which way is it going to say? That way. That's wrong, right? It's because the force is inherently in spherical coordinates. There's no way to write it with a single equation in Cartesian coordinates. So when you set up a problem like this, we'll do it with charge and electrostatics later, because that's also spherical, meaning next semester. But if you start to just say, move a mass between these masses, you actually have to write a new Cartesian equation for every gap between masses. Because if you move one past the other, it'll be wrong in Cartesian coordinates. And it's because the direction of the radial unit vector flips in spherical coordinates. See, if I go on this side, it's spherical, the radial unit vector is that way. If I go here, the radial unit vector is that way. In Cartesian coordinates, if I go here, the x hat vector is that way. If I go here, it's still that way. So in Cartesian coordinates, the unit vectors always stay the same direction, no matter where you go. In spherical coordinates, they flip around. Okay, so if I had been thinking about this correctly, I would have realized this was the force that one applies to two. And we would have just been thinking about this force, and I would have said, look, the force two feels is pointing this way, negative r hat. All right, then it would have made sense. And then if I bring two over here, it feels a force that way, but that's also negative r hat, because over here, r hat is now this way, because r hat can switch. There you go. So I made both of them correct. Okay. So this is just sort of, to me, this is evidence for the malevolent nature of God. Okay, because Cartesian coordinates, all the math is easy. Calculus in Cartesian coordinates, two semesters and you're done. But what is the third semester? Vector calculus. And the whole reason vector calculus is hard is because we have to do the calculus in spherical coordinates, because the universe is in spherical coordinates, right? If God had just made all the interactions in Cartesian coordinates, where the math is easy, this would all be easy. Calculus, two semester, physics would be easy. Nothing, you know, it'd be much easier. Now, we may not have actually ended up with stable matter and evolved to exist, but I would give that up if we didn't have to do vector calculus. But we do, so anyway. So it's God's fault, you know. Let me flip, and I've got an example here where we're gonna think about this direction stuff, where we do a quick calculation. Actually, I have a religious opportunity for you. If you would like to join me, I have started a religion called agnostic vigilantism. Okay, so that means not sure if there's a God, but if I find out that there is, I'm going to kick his ass, mostly over that Cartesian spherical thing. Okay. So now to think about directions, what we got to do is bring up two forces and have to add them. Right. That's what's going to make it difficult. So what force do you feel halfway between the Earth and the Sun? So let us think about directions. It'll get us practice using the big numbers for astronomical questions, because you do that a lot in the homework. And the answer is kind of interesting, actually. So here's the Sun. I always draw the Sun with sunglasses, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense, and smiling. There he is, there's Sun. And here is the Earth. There's some Pangea stuff going on there. And we have an axis between the two, and you are halfway between the Sun and the Earth. What force do you feel? So you're gonna need some numbers to do this. We're gonna start giving them to you all the time. Mass of the Sun is 2 × 10⁻³ kilograms. The mass of the Earth is 6 × 10⁴ kilograms. Check your work, is the Sun should be higher. And the radius, oh my goodness, the distance from the Earth to the Sun is 150 × 10⁹ meters. That's also called an astronomical unit. So if you ever see AU in a paper, that's like a standard distance. Okay, so what we gotta do then is, what force do you feel is the net force, right? We need to add these two forces. So we need the force that the Earth applies to you. That'll be attractive, force Earth on you, and the force the Sun applies to you. And we just need to add them up, respecting, you know, vector addition. Maybe they're in different directions. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna write it. I'm gonna do it in vector formula, just so you'll see the whole thing. The net force, and I'm gonna attempt it in Cartesian coordinates, and you'll see where I have to make an adjustment to do that. If this is the positive x direction, I'm gonna say it's negative 6.67 × 10⁻¹ times the mass of the Sun, 2 × 10⁻³ times the mass of me, 70, more or less, over the distance, divide that by 2, we're halfway between, right? 75 × 10⁹, so I know you can't read this, but you know what numbers to put in. So I've plugged in all those numbers. So those are all, I'll say the negative is there because it's attractive gravity. So this is all I have. All right. There's I hat. And now there's a second force though. This is the net force. That was the force of the Sun on you. And if I do it in negative I hat, it comes out the right direction. That's all fine. Now I want to do the force of the earth on you. If I use that negative in right I hat, it's going to come out negative also, but we know it's in the other direction. See, you can't do it purely in Cartesian. We have to artificially, with our mind, make it positive. The same thing we do when we use magnitudes instead of vector notation. It's really not different. I'm just trying to remind you that you have to think about which way the force is, because you have to do it artificially, because this force is spherical and you're doing it in Cartesian. So we know that it's attractive, so we know it's that way, so we know that's positive x, so it'll be plus, and it's relevant because it's so small compared to the other one, but we'll calculate anyway. Times 10 to the minus 11, there's g, there's 6 times 10 to the 24. You can run these on your own later and check and see if you get the same thing. Also, 75 times 10 to the 9 squared, also I hat. But we've made it positive. All right. So when you do that, I don't really want to go through all the numbers. We don't have a lot of time. But in the end, this one is a lot bigger than this one. And you can see why. Same. The mass is a million times bigger. So this term is going to be a million times bigger. So you're going to get negative. And you actually get negative 5 newtons. All right. I cannot hear. I think it's just... Oops. And can I hear? No. Uh-oh. Okay, good. We're back. Okay. We can hear. Minus 5 newtons. All right. So that's the answer. It's dominated by the sun's force because you're... Remember, the distance is the same, but the mass is much bigger. And that's actually kind of weird. So this is a misconception people have, that when you're in space, once you get to low Earth orbit, you're weightless. There's no gravity. Of course not. The reason you're orbiting the Earth is because there's gravity. We're doing that in the second half. But even if you get far away from the Earth, say you get halfway to the sun. Oh, there's no gravity. I'm fine. No, the sun is big, right? The sun drives the entire solar system. So think about that. 5 newtons, your acceleration... So let's say you're only 50 kilograms, your acceleration would be 0.1 meters per second squared. So in 100 seconds, you're going to be going like world-class sprinter speed towards the sun. So you're very screwed, right? So the sun is a very strong force, very deep well. As soon as you get away from the Earth, you're completely dominated by the sun. So when you read about these missions to Mars and other the distant planets, they do all these gravitational slingshots because they can't just use their fuel to get that far from the sun. It would take too much. That's why they have to loop around so much. So it's actually the sun's gravity that's much more influential than the Earth. So the hard part of getting on the Earth is the atmosphere is in the way, right? And you have to burn through the atmosphere and all the friction. Anyway, I know you wanted to know all that. Okay, so that is that. I think it's break time. Let me see what time it is. I don't know what break time it is anymore. I think this is exactly break time. 10, 40, 20, 40, 10, 10. Yeah, no, we're at break time. Okay, so... I think organizationally the class is going well. We're getting less questions than usual about how the class works, but the exam is coming, and I predict that there's going to be some questions as the exam approaches. Now, there is one source of information, so I have a special guest to talk to you about where you can get this information. I'll play it during the break, but we are on our 5-minute break.
A message from Big Snoop D-O-double-G to all the university students. Yo, syllabus. You gotta do it. You gotta read it. Man, I'm telling you, the more you know, the further you go. Tell them Snoop Dogg sent you. Syllabus. I know all about it. Catch up so we can have a conversation. Don't be late. Let's go. Thank you.
right, so everything's working. So yeah, if you have questions about how the class runs, listen to Professor D-O-double-G and read the syllabus. But we will be telling you about the exam coming up. And for the record, I did just find that Cameo online and I did not pay for it. But I did donate $1 for every person in this class to the Snoop Youth Football League. So we sort of stole the Cameo, but we helped the kids, so we feel good about that. All right. They aren't playing this fall, of course, but they do plan to play next fall. All right.
Jason, can I say something?
Okay, so now we're going to do... Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, oh, yeah. We're back with Dr. Thurston. What do you got?
Yes. I just wanted to point out, in case anyone hasn't recognized or didn't realize, to this point in the lecture, which is the halfway point, we've already had as many or slightly more questions than a full lecture usually gets. So this lecture, I think, is particularly challenging for students. A lot of questions, a lot of things they are asking about. So they're going to want to pay attention to this one, review it. Maybe we want to spend some time on it next week. But this is getting
twice as many questions. Is it more the circular motion, or is it more the gravitational forces?
I think mostly circular motion, but it's been maybe two-thirds, a third split, maybe, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
Your vector notation.
That's good. Yeah, I can slow down a little bit because I'm actually short of material for the second half. So there you go. That's going to be stretching things. Okay, yeah, we'll definitely review it, watch it. Maybe watch it at 0.5x. Don't watch it at 2x. And although I guess one thing I'll point out is all this gravitational stuff I'm telling you about directions and the confusion about spherical and Cartesian unit vectors, you don't really have to be an expert at that to do all the problems. That insight might help you for some problems, but if you're just good at plugging in GMM over R squared, you're going to get 90% of these right. Right? I don't think the people that write the MCAT actually are aware of this. So I'm trying to put you, if you're smarter than the people that write the MCAT, you're going to do really well. All right. So let's now then, what we're going to do now is explain why there's two gravities, right? Why is there just F equals mg, or weight equals mg, and then also GMM over R squared? And which one is real, right? Which one is an approximation? Okay, so let's say, what if you are near a planet and close to it? And as always, any physics setup requires a little bit of understanding of the world, okay? So literally the world in this case. So one thing I did not write that is you're gonna have to assume is you are small compared to the planet, all right? So you know how big you are, you know how big planets are. So we're gonna, that's my example of, you know, everything is not always stated. Sometimes you gotta look for information that we try to make it so general that everyone would know. So for example here, let's say the planet is, oh, I don't know, how about the Earth? Right, so let's say here's the Earth, right? And you are right here, not even to scale here. You know, I can't draw it to scale. You're so small on the Earth. The Earth has a radius RE like that. And it has a mass we've talked about, ME, like that. Right? And you're sitting right there. So let's calculate. Let's not worry about directions. Let's just calculate the magnitude, the force that the Earth applies to you, all right? The magnitude of the force, not worrying about direction, is GMM over R squared. Big G, mass of the Earth, mass of you, over that separation square. We'll call it R squared, okay? There it is. So what is R in this case? Well, R, it's the radius of the Earth plus, like, how tall you are, you know? I mean, I could put half of your height, I guess, because, you know, the center of your mass is kind of half. Okay, sure, we can put half of how tall you are, like that, okay? Or if you're up in an airplane, it would be, what is your, like, altitude? Maybe you're 50,000 feet in the air. So you could put 50,000 feet in there, or however high airplanes fly. So let's look at some numbers then. The radius of the Earth, I think we used it before, is 6,371 meters. 6 million meters, 6,000 kilometers, okay? Now, let's think about your height. Like, what's the highest you're ever gonna get? I mean, currently, you know, the whole space tourism thing may happen, but without space tourism, you're going in an airplane. So I would say H max, the highest you're ever gonna go, is 9,000 meters. Okay, so to scale, that's like here. It's like the width of the chalk. I still can't draw it. You're basically still on the surface of the Earth, okay? So now we're gonna plug these into here. And we're gonna say this equals big G, mass of the Earth, mass of U over the radius of the Earth plus that height squared. Let's not do this, this is silly. Let's leave that half out. That's just gonna confuse you. It's how high you are. If you're standing, it's half that, okay? If you're in an airplane, it's 9,000. But let's look at this, and now we're going to do something that physicists do. You just gotta get used to. Okay, we don't make you do it too much, okay? But it's approximations. It's about how do you get real numbers in the real world. And what you would do here is anytime you see two numbers added, you ask yourself, is one of them a lot bigger one than the other? And if it is, you take the little one and you put an arrow through it and you write zero. And we're gonna say, we're gonna approximate this to be zero. So here we're adding the radius of the Earth to how high we are above the surface of the Earth. And you see 9,000 is the highest this can be ever be. And this is 6.3 million. So this is small. I could calculate this just putting 6.371 million, or I could calculate it putting 6.38 million. And it's not really gonna be that different. You're gonna get basically the same answer. So what we do is we say, let's approximate that to be zero. Approximations is the only way to get through physics. Often, if this class inspires you to be a physics major, it's happened. Stop laughing. Hold on, wait. There's no laughing at that. That wasn't a joke. If this class inspires you to be a physics major, it hasn't happened while I've been teaching it, but I've heard that it's happened in the history of the organization. Also, when you just start, you're like, I'm going to be the person that does it without the approximations. So you leave it in there, and this blows up, and you square it, and you foil it, and then you point at another thing, and it gets bigger and bigger, and then you fill up a notebook, and then you do it online, and it fills, and eventually you realize, oh, I'm not learning anything new here. The essential physics I'm doing is more clear when you make the approximations. And adding all these teeny little fudge factor details don't actually affect the answers. And it goes beyond just calculating values, also solving differential equations to get the dynamic behavior of something. Often it's critical to apply approximations to throw away little terms that make the equation more complicated than it needs to be, make it nonlinear. So this is a very natural thing to do. This isn't me just trying to cheat and get through the lecture. All right, so if we're gonna make that zero, now we can start messing around here. So we could say, let's rearrange this a little bit and write the mass of U right there. And let's put all this together and realize big G, constant of the universe, ME, constant of the Earth, and radius of the Earth squared, constant of the Earth. And what we have is that the force that the Earth applies to you is your mass times a bunch of constants. All right, and what do you think those constants are gonna make if we calculate big G ME over RE squared, plug in the numbers, do it, and you will get 9.8 meters per second squared. This is little g, okay? So the key is that this approximation that weight is just mg, and g is a constant 9.8, that is an approximation for being near the surface of the Earth. That's all it is. It's not a universal law. And this is what Newton figured out. He figured out that this is just that, and that's why it all works, right? You can also now use this in our problems to figure out what's the weight or the local gravity somewhere else. Is you basically just plug other planetary values into here. The mass of the planet, how big is the planet? Mass of the asteroid, how big is the asteroid? G is constant. And what you find is lower gravity in other places. Right? The moon, much lower mass. Also a lower radius, but a much lower mass. And this is much lower, like a sixth. So that's why things have less weight on the moon. Mars, smaller than the Earth. So the gravity is a little bit lower than the value on the Earth. Okay. So the way we make all these problems interesting is do this problem on another planet and, you know, see what you get. All right. Now, you might say, what if we break this approximation? I mean, you're that person that's going to major, and you want to stick your values in here, and you can. Or if you're doing very precision measurements, it matters. So if you measure the acceleration due to gravity as you go up, it drops, right? It's 9.81 here, and it's 9.809 here. And it's actually a measurable amount. You can get very sensitive accelerometers that measure gravity, and as you go up, the value goes down. Also, the Earth is not uniform. So if you move around the Earth with different sensitive gravitometers or acceleration meters, you can detect that there's something really heavy under the Earth there, or there's something really light under the Earth here. And this is how we do the most important thing in the world, the second most important use of physics. Number one is war, but number two is finding oil, okay? So you fly an airplane, a gravitometer around the Gulf of Mexico, and you look at the fluctuations in G, and that gives you ideas whether there might be oil. And a Rice professor made a lot of money off that in the 60s, and I got to go to parties at his house that paid for that. So not in the 60s, I wasn't alive in the 60s. Okay, so anyway, that is the connection between general G, we're talking about big bodies in space, little bodies, fun calculations, and then things in the source theory. Probably should have done that first, then maybe that would make more sense. All right, I'm gonna talk about another thing related. Dr. Simpson, maybe this lecture isn't confusing. Maybe you've just developed such a rapport with the students that they're very comfortable asking questions. I'm going to assume that's the case.
We'll see.
It's just that we're both so good. I think that's what it is. Okay. Oops. Okay, so now, here we go. Let's ask another fun question. Is it possible to achieve circular motion around a planet? I didn't read this ahead of time, so I'm excited to see what's... because FG points to the center. Remember, the definition of really uniform circular motion is the type we're talking about, is that the force is perpendicular to the motion. So we could go back to this idea. We sort of talked about it when we were shooting things. We were doing a trajectory shoot and drop. And I think I showed the video or something where I get all mad because we settle this up and we talked about how horizontal and vertical are separate. And no matter how fast you shoot it, they'll fall the same, but they really won't because eventually there's curvature of the Earth. So our model, our approximation then, was that everything is flat, infinitely flat, which of course it isn't, right? It's really round. So the idea is we shoot, it'll go like that. Shoot, go like that. Shoot harder, it'll go like that. Shoot harder, it'll go like that. But eventually, the question is, could you do this? And based on what we've learned, you can. Because if you're doing this, you have the case, I'll draw it here, that V is like that. And all we need for uniform circular motion is for the acceleration and the force to be perpendicular. And it is, because it's to the center of the Earth. Right? So you could have circular motion around a planet if you're going fast enough. So let's, for fun, first calculate it for near the surface. If I'm doing a demo at Hersey Amphitheater and I shoot something faster and faster and faster, how fast would I have to shoot it to put it in a near Earth orbit? So near the surface, it would look like this. Well, we just think about the centripetal direction. Uniform circular motion. Some of the forces in the centripetal direction equals the mass of the acceleration in the centripetal direction. What is this force? Well, it's mg. And then if we're near the surface of the Earth, it's m little g. Let's calculate that. Equals its mass. And what is the centripetal acceleration? Well, we're thinking about how fast do we have to go? Vt, so let's put Vt squared over r, right? And what would the radius of that circle be? It would be essentially the radius of the Earth, right? You could add the height, remember, but the height is really small, so we're just thinking near the surface of the Earth. So if you solve that, you get that this velocity, this tangential velocity you would have to shoot at, is the square root of gre. And is that fast? Yes. This is 10, this is 9.8, and the radius of the Earth was 6,000 kilometers. So, 6 million meters. So you multiply that, you take the square root, and you get 7,900 meters per second. Wow, that's pretty fast. That would go around the Earth in 84 minutes. Let's do some circular motion. How did I do that? Around the Earth. So what is T? Like the period to go around the Earth. For that, remember, uniform circular motion is at constant speed. So you just kind of do D equals VT and pretend it's one-dimensional motion. All right, so D would be the circumference, 2 pi radius of the Earth. V is that, 7,900. And then T would be that period we're looking for. So you could calculate something like that. Often these kind of problems, as you start, you really want the period. You see, you could solve this for the period instead of the, anyway. Yeah, we do that, that's how I got 84 minutes. I calculated that to give you an idea that that's really fast, right? So this won't really work. I mean, physically this will work, but in the real world, it won't work because if you go that fast in the atmosphere, you'll incinerate. And of course you would run into buildings and trees and problems like that. So this is not really how you normally do an orbit calculation because you don't do them that close to the surface of the Earth. Let's look at the calculation for a real satellite. Let me just erase real fast. It's the same thing, really, but we'll use, you know, the general gravitational force. And we're not going to use sort of mg and pretend that it's really close. It's really far away, so we can't use that one. So in this case, you have the Earth kind of like this, and you'd have some satellite out in space, not super close to the surface. So we define the radius from the center of the Earth. If you look up tables of how high satellites are, they may give the number above from the surface. But of course, the formula we want to use in these equations assumes everything is a point particle. So we go with the center of the Earth. So it's the same thing. We say, here's the satellite, it's moving. Vt, it's accelerating that way. So we just find Newton's law. Sum of the forces, the centripetal acceleration is the mass times the centripetal acceleration. Little m is just going to be the satellite mass. I won't put a subscript on it. And this big me is the mass of the Earth. Something like that. All right. So the force, then, it only feels one force. The Earth is pulling on it. Right? There's no normal forces. There's no friction. There's no tension. I don't know what our other one was. Oh, it was weight. That's what we're doing. So big G, mass of the Earth, the mass of the little satellite over what we're calling r squared, okay, equals, and it's circular motion, if it's this kind of over, mv squared over r. Little m, v squared, vt, because it's a tangential, that's what we like to call it, over the same big R, like that, right? The force equals mass times the tangential, or times the centripetal acceleration. Okay, so we can look at that and say, well, some stuff cancels. Look, it doesn't matter about the mass of the satellite. That's interesting. We are applying some approximations here. We always are. This doesn't really sit still while this goes around. They actually both go around each other. So if we did that complicated motion, then the mass might stay. But in this simple thing where the Earth doesn't move and this is in circular motion around it, the math goes away. Another thing we can cancel is there's an R in the bottom of each one, so that becomes a 1. So then you can basically see it's just VT squared equals GME over R. So we take a square root to get how fast is that satellite need to go? GME over how high it is. Right? And that's basically the speed of a satellite. And what you see is the further out, the slower it goes. And you can see that because right there, as R gets bigger, it'll go slower. For satellites around the Earth, they all have the same G, they all have the same ME. Right? It's just how far are you from this thing. So let's think, what satellite do we want to run this on? Like, it'd be good to check our numbers, you know? So let's check our numbers here. Let's think of a satellite we could do this with. My 84 minute period Hershey amphitheater bullet isn't very realistic. So let's do the moon. I mean, it's a satellite, it's going around the Earth. Let's see what, we know what the numbers are. So let's see how that goes. So we know that here's the Earth and here's the moon, and we'll pretend it's a perfectly circular orbit, right, like this. And we know the distance from the Earth to the moon, that is known, and we know the mass of the Earth and the moon. So it's really just a plug and chug problem if you're asked to do this. But we know that then how fast it's going. We can see how fast the moon goes. That's an interesting question. G mass of the Earth over the radius or the distance from the Earth to the moon. Numbers like this we'll be giving you in problems as we go. So it's the square root. Let's practice our plug in here. 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. And G, constant of the universe. Mass of the Earth, 6 times 10 to the 24 in kilograms, standard number. And then, oh, here's the number at everyone's fingertips. 384 times 10 to the 6 meters. Okay. And you could kind of check it. You could remember, well, the radius of the Earth was 6 times 10 to the 6. So yeah, the moon should probably be a lot bigger. So that's how far the moon is. So when you solve that, you get about 1,021 meters per second. So we'll say, is this reasonable? Well, it's slower than the bullet at the surface of the Earth. So that's good, because it's supposed to slow down as you go farther away, right? That was like 7,000 meters per second. And yeah, that seems pretty fast. The one way we could check it is with our knowledge of circular motion to say, what's the period? How long does it take it to go around this orbital path? All right, so this is how fast it's going. And we just d equals vt, how long does it take? All right. So the d is the circumference of the moon's path, right? 2 pi times that, 2 pi, so 3.8, 384. V. We just calculated it, 1021. And T, the T at time, that's the period, T. All right, so the period equals, I get 2.36 times 10 to the 6 seconds. Not that great, but let's convert it to minutes, and then let's convert it to hours, and convert it to days, and it's 27 days. Exactly what it should be. Right? We know the moon goes around once a month, but the phases of the moon happen roughly once a month. Okay. need to look at the time real quick. All right, so I'm gonna do this last little interesting part, and then we'll probably have like 5 minutes, and I can just answer questions. Let's try that. I took out a couple of super complicated things that would have taken too long. All right. So this ties to the biggest question in physics right now, which is, what is dark matter? Just talk about that for a second. Kind of fun, right? Dark matter, are you kidding me? Cosmologists, you know, they have a bad idea. It goes in the press and they get a lot of money. Some of us aren't so lucky. Okay, so if we look at how fast those things are going, it was a square root of big G, mass of the Earth, over how far they are, right? So let's think about the solar system instead. Let's make this the mass of the sun. And then it's how far every planet is. Okay, so what that means is you could make a plot like this of how fast is each one of these going, each planet going, and how far are they away? Okay, Mercury is really close, goes something like that. And then you've got Venus, something like that. And then Earth, something like that. And Mars, and then, oh crap, what's after the Jupiter, I think. Okay. So they go down as 1/r², or 1/√r. All right, so Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, etc. And it makes perfect curve. Everybody's happy. Gravity's correct. Everything's fine, right? You could do all the other planets. You could throw asteroids and moons on there. But now, let's do it for the solar system. Let's do it for stars in a galaxy. All right, they've imaged long enough, they can watch a galaxy rotate or something. They have some way to do this. And maybe it's from the Doppler shift. And you can do the same thing. You can say, how fast is the star moving as you get farther and farther away from the galaxy? Okay. So I'm showing you actually know enough now to completely understand this. So you'd say, well, I understand this. I know that stars close to the galactic center should be going fast, just like the bullet near the surface of the Earth went fast. If I let this number get small, this number gets big, you get that. So you look at the stars near the surface, and that's fine. And stars a little farther away, fine. Stars a little farther away, fine. And then you're like, hey, this is looking good. And then suddenly it does this. It should go down. And the stars that are far away are not following this rule. They're going too fast. Why? I don't know. Nobody knows. So the idea is somewhere in this galaxy, I mean, one, you could, there's lots of things you could say. Gravity's wrong, and there's other exponents, but they have hundreds of reasons that that's not the case. My favorite is that not all galaxies do this. It's like there's clumpy something going on. It's not this universal something going on. And so the idea is these are going too fast. So the idea is that there must be other matter moving things around that we can't see. So that's what's called dark matter. Then you could say, well, maybe it's just like cold, dark rocks that aren't emitting light. But any matter we understand will at least scatter light. And any matter we understand is at some temperature and emits thermal radiation. So we can see all normal matter with telescopes and various methods. But there's some sort of matter that seems to be affecting these curves. They don't know what it is. So lots of money is going into trying to figure out what it is. Right? You can understand that now, just based on the simple things that we talked about. Okay, so I don't know how, maybe we were confused because I went so fast. I finished like an entire lecture. I have 8 minutes. So why don't we just, if you want to leave, you can, but I'll sit here and we can try to do general questions. Or I could make up a problem. That's not my head. So. I assume everybody's typing them in, and Dr. Stinson will have one in a second. Or everybody's already gone.
Someone just asked if we can do another circular motion problem. I guess they're just, I don't know what they want to target on that, but that's what they asked for.
We could do over, you know, going over a hill real quick. You want to do going over a hill? It's on the homework, but I could get you started. Let's see.
Yeah, that'd probably be good.
Because I have a feeling that's what's really confusing people so much. So going over a hill, like, what's the max speed that you can take and go over this hill and stay on the road, okay, when you're here? Because that's the only time that it's circular motion. Because then you're going straight, but your force is only that way. Right? The forces are perpendicular to V. That's when it's circular motion. And we would basically tell you that part because we would say the minimum maximum speed at the top. You know, we're not going to ask you at a place that where it's not in uniform circular motion. So not in this class. Okay, so max speed is speed to stay on the road. Free body diagram. Mg up is normal. Okay. We could say Newton's second law in the vertical direction. So the normal force minus mg. I'm sorry, it's not even, okay, that's fine. I'm sitting here being stupid. Yeah, so the normal force is up, mg is down, but what is the acceleration in this direction? It's the centripetal acceleration. And the way I drew it, it's down, minus mac. Right, so this is really Newton's second law in the centripetal direction. I confused myself because I said vertical, but it's both the centripetal and the vertical direction. So some of the forces, Newton, normal force up, weight down, equals m times ac. So m in Newton's second law, ac is, we know, is the only acceleration, and I am making it negative because I'm doing magnitudes, right? So that's why it says negative mac. Okay. So then you ask, what is sort of the max or min speed to stay on the road? So you can sort of go through the same thought process. You know, these are all the speeds you could go from really slow to really fast. So if you use your intuition, if I go really slow, VT slow, am I going to fly off the road? No, I'm going to stay on the road. And if I go VT really fast, and use your intuition or watch bullet. If you're really fast, is that when maybe you'll fly off the road? If you go too fast, you'll fly off the road. So you got to think, what is the sort of condition? What's going on here where I might fly off the road? So the negative sign is annoying. You could say, we should have made down positive. We could say minus n plus mg equals plus mac, I guess. Because then you can think through it this way. When you're going really slow, this is really small, okay? Going all the way down to zero, because this is V squared, VT squared over R. If this is really small, can this thing be really small? Yes, right? That's a constant. N can take any value from zero to some value. So N can just grow to mg. And then you have negative mg plus mg equals zero. You're essentially solving it if you're essentially not moving it. And you are solving if you're not moving. If you're not moving, then that size is zero, and that's when the normal force equals the weight. If you start moving just a little bit, now you need this to be some little value above zero, so you get a little bit less normal force. Right? That's why when you go over that hill, but you stay on the road, you feel lighter. The normal force is going down so that the weight can be reduced. The normal force, I'm sorry, the magnitude of the normal force is increasing so that it can cancel part of the weight to give you this downward acceleration you need. Now, what if you go really fast? Now, this is big, right? Really big, and this is only a certain size, and can this make it any bigger? No. All this can do is make it smaller. There's a negative sign there, this is a magnitude. The normal force can't push it down in this case. So here you'll fly off. So there's some point in between where you go from staying on to flying off. And that is where, what's the magic thing that happens? The normal force can only get so small and then it goes to zero. So it's where n equals zero. This is exactly like the other one. It's just, you know, it's just this is negative or positive, and it's the other way or the same way. So solving it is the exact same process. You can make that equal zero. Cancel, cancel, and the square root of G R. All right, so VT. So like I think I hinted to you last time, the answer is always the square root of GR. It's just, how do you get there? So we might try to think of, like, if I had to make a fun out-of-the-box question on this, I might say, how fast do you need to go to where it feels like you're half your normal weight? Half your weight that you would feel at rest. All right, so it'd probably be something like making this a half mg. And that would tell you how fast you need to go. So there's little ways we can mess with it. But I don't want to make up complicated problems off the top of my head because that usually doesn't go well. Okay, so that was one circular motion problem. Be more specific if you have a certain kind you want to see. You have 1 minute. But I assume this was the confusing thing.
Just for future, you probably don't have time for another question, but just for future reference, there's a lot of questions about R hat unit vectors. People are getting a little nervous about, you know, the unit vector stuff with spherical coordinates.
Yeah.
And then on that last question, someone asked why was N equal to zero and also why was MA, why'd you make that negative? Why'd you make the MA in the force sum negative? And
yeah, because I was doing a problem where I made this the positive positive centripetal direction. Right, so those were magnitudes I was putting in the directions.
Right.
I could write this vector plus this vector equals this vector. That is the general sum of the forces equals in the centripetal direction equals Maslin's acceleration in the centripetal direction. But often we like to put in our intuitive knowledge of the signs by just writing the magnitudes. And I did a free body diagram where I knew that normal was up and I knew mg is down. And I know that the centripetal acceleration is down because it seeks the center and this is the circular path. That's how I knew it was down. So that's why I wrote n minus mg equals minus mac. All right. So it's a quick update on that if you're still there. But now we're out of time. I don't want to go over because people can't stay. But obviously, office hours, we have all next week to review. I'm going to be putting out things asking you, what do you want me to talk about next week? So we'll definitely clear up things like this. Okay, see you guys next week or whenever.